thank you for coming tonight and welcome you to our event. You can all hear me.
I don't think we need to.
Tonight, we want to thank Gordon Ridgway for allowing us to use this lovely library. And I'm going to turn everything over to Liz.
Okay, 10 years ago, in 2005, that a Democrat activist in the towns of the first, the towns up here, eight towns in the northwest corner, we started the Democratic Coalition of Northwest Connecticut. And we asked, in our first event, we asked Attorney General Richard Blumenthal to come and talk about how to be an activist. So we are so delighted on our 10th anniversary to be able to have now Senator Blumenthal to come and talk to us tonight.
Thank you so much. If anyone can't hear me, just speak up and I'll speak louder. Wonderful to be with you on your 10th anniversary. Actually, just a week or so ago, I was out here on Cornwall's 275th anniversary. And I don't know whether any of you were there. It was a wonderful parade and then a ceremony, and reminded me of how much I love this part of the state, how much I love Cornwall and the northwest part of Connecticut, and how grateful I am always to be here, particularly during the summer. How easy to get here during the summer. And thanks to Liz and Gordon and all of you for giving this opportunity to be with you again. I want to talk a little bit about what I do and what I've been working on, but mostly I would love to take your questions and hear your viewpoints, and if you have any advice for me, really, how to deal with the frustration and the dysfunction that you see, and I see, and I feel so frustratingly so often in Washington, D.C. You know, I used to have a job, talking about 2005, when I wasn't a U.S. Senator, but as Attorney General, I said something, and something happened. Now, I say something, and I'm lucky if anyone's listening. But actually, this is a wonderful opportunity, really it's the opportunity of a lifetime, to work on some of the causes that have so passionately engaged me over many years. Work on them in a different way, but many of the same issues and some broader ones. And I'll just give you some examples. Despite the dysfunction, I am on some great committees where I can make things happen. The Judiciary Committee, where criminal law reforms in the way we now do incarceration. We imprison too many people, a lot of them non-dangerous people, in the federal system and likewise in the state system. A great cost to our society, not only in dollars and cents, but human beings. And I've been working on criminal justice reform. On cybersecurity, where as a lawyer, as Attorney General, I've been able to play a very instrumental role in proposing some of the reforms that are incorporated in the President's proposal, like an independent advocate when the country is trying to decide whether to do surveillance. Having an advocate for constitutional rights, reforming the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, I've been able to play a role there. And, of course, on immigration reform, where we passed a bipartisan bill overwhelmingly to provide a path to citizenship for the 11 million people who are already in this country. I was on the subcommittee and the group that helped to put together that proposal. I still have hope that it will pass again and that it will be adopted by the House, and on a variety of other issues having to do with investment, investing in our future, our rails, our roads, our bridges. I'm on the Commerce Committee and have been involved in trying to improve safety and reliability in our railroads and our roads, our basic infrastructure. We now spend a fraction of what we should investing. It's not spending as much as it is investing to maintain and enhance, rebuild our roads and bridges. You all travel on them, but also our rail. People go to China and they say, China has a better rail system than the United States. Why is that? Well, China spends close to 10% of its gross domestic product on infrastructure. We spend less than 2%. And so I propose, again, on a bipartisan basis, an infrastructure bank, a national public financing authority, that I think represents a hope to provide the kind of investment that we have to do. And then investing in our people, skill training, education. The president has proposed tuition-free community college. And I have visited all the community colleges in our state, but also the vocational and technical schools that provide the kinds of skills that are necessary in today's workplace. Investing in that education and eliminating, or at least reducing, some of the debt that students now have, making college more affordable. College debt, debt resulting from college loans, is now the biggest consumer debt in the United States. It's the biggest debt at $1.4 trillion, except for mortgages, that anyone else would have. It's no longer possible for anyone to work their way through school. Many of us went through school in an era when that was possible. It's no longer possible. And now an average of $60,000 or $70,000 debt is what students emerge from college bearing, and it is really financially crippling to them, and it is inhibiting to our economy, to economic growth, because those young people can't start families or start businesses or buy homes or make themselves as free economically, and that's a burden on our whole economy. But I've also continued work on consumer issues on the Commerce Committee, defective ignition switches in automobiles, exploding airbags, some of the other consumer issues that have been so important to me as the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Consumer Protection on the Commerce Committee. I've been able to continue those interests, and we have a number of investigations, for example, airline fees, where I recommended to the Department of Justice they begin an investigation, and they did. And now we're looking into the fees that are charged for baggage and cancellations and really nuts and bolts kind of thing that affects people. The safety of their automobiles, the cost to them of air travel, the safety of roads and bridges. It's a great opportunity to try to affect those issues. And I'll just finish on this note. Probably the best two committees that I have, Armed Services and Veterans Affairs. I'm the ranking member on Veterans Affairs. And of course, that is a very bipartisan committee, should be. And I think probably my best day in the Senate so far was when I went to the White House for a bill signing on a measure called the Clay Hunt Veterans Suicide Prevention Act. Believe it or not, in this country, greatest country in the history of the world, 22 veterans every day, 22 veterans take their own lives. Think of that for a moment. 22 veterans take their own lives. And they are victims of the invisible wounds of war, post-traumatic stress, and traumatic brain injury. Those wounds come back with them, even after they fought abroad, in Iraq or Afghanistan. They often lose the battle at home. And often, all too often, the VA, Veterans Administration, fails them. And it failed Clay Hunt. The bill was named after him. Clay Hunt was a Marine, went to Afghanistan. One of my sons was in the Marine Corps and went to Afghanistan, Marine Corps Reserve. And so did Clay Hunt. He came back. And the VA failed him. Those inner demons, post-traumatic stress, the rage and nightmares and anxiety eventually get him in. And he fell between the cracks at the VA and fell into the dark hole of depression that eventually caused him to take his own life. When I learned about him and learned about this issue and saw it in a very personal way, because I met families in Connecticut who lost their loved ones in the same way. Justin Eldridge, also a Marine, also served there. Justin took his own life and he left his widow, Joanna Eldridge, in the New London area, just as an example. And I worked with John McCain. The two of us got together. We introduced the Clay Hunt Veterans Suicide Prevention Bill. And it'll provide more health care, more mental health care, more research into what the causes and treatments are, more outreach and community support. And we went, he and I, McCain and I, stood next to the president as he signed that bill, and next to us was Clay Hunt's mom. And I looked out at the military families who have lost loved ones as a result of veteran suicide. And it was a very moving and powerful moment for me, because I think it will make a difference. It's only a down payment, it's only a beginning of what we need to do to improve mental health care for our veterans and health care generally, and other kinds of needs that they have, skills, jobs, education, homelessness. We are only beginning to realize what the costs of this war have been, and we're only beginning to pay for them. So, as much as I feel that frustration, there are areas where, on a bipartisan basis, and to get things done, you got to work on a bipartisan basis, you have to reach across the aisle. I have felt a lot of satisfaction, and working on issues that are sometimes controversial. I was the leader of the effort to stop defunding of Planned Parenthood. Sometimes we win by stopping bad things from happening. And that was, by the way, the eighth time that the effort to defund Planned Parenthood occurred in the Senate. And there'll probably be more. And so the kinds of things that we can get done are really take a lot of work, a lot of patience. I don't get to a court anymore, but there are tremendous satisfactions in this job, and all of that is simply to say thank you for being such great friends, such supporters. Thank you for being there for me, because as you know, it wasn't easy to get to this job. I had to overcome a fairly substantial set of odds, but I said then, and I'll tell you again now, I had something money can't buy. Much as there's talk about the importance of campaign funding, at the end of the day, activists, go back to 2005, right? Activists, engaged citizens on the environment, on consumer issues, ultimately make the difference. That's what made a difference for me. So I'm here to say thank you. I'm 10 years later than I should have been. But at least I'm not 275 years later. And thank you for having me tonight. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Senator, I think that many of us here in the room are interested in your views on two agreements. One of them are these free trade agreements, such as the TPP. Most of the argument is about economics and jobs, but it seems to me there's a legal question there, where the tribunals claim to be able to overturn laws previously adopted by Congress on, for example, country of origin, labeling country of origin of meat products sold in the United States, or organic products, or dolphin-free nets. So I'm really interested in your legal aspect of that. The other thing I'd just like to mention is that Ben is here, and he's going to have a question for you, because he worked on the original non-proliferation treaty that included Iran, back in 1972. I think he has a question on your views about where we are now with this new proposed agreement.
You're going to let him ask your question? let me take them. You want me to discuss both?
Yeah.
First, on the fast track trade proposal, I voted against it, so did my colleague and friend Chris Murphy. I voted against it partly because of the legal issue and the possibility that, in fact, a trade agreement would be rammed through without the possibility for Congress to amend it, which I think Congress has a obligatory role to consider doing. We can't just accept what the administration gives to us. And so I voted against fast track because of the impact on workers, on our economy, and on our environmental standards as well. On Iran, I'll just be very blunt. I have not made a decision about whether I will vote to reject the agreement or not. And I think that there are weaknesses in this agreement. The President has said he's right, no agreement is perfect. The Secretary of State has said negotiations always involve compromise. That's true. The question is whether those weaknesses justify voting against the agreement. And the key question is, what will happen if Congress rejects it? What are the alternatives? What will happen as a practical matter? Because the question is not whether we would have, you or I, negotiated a better deal. There may have been a better deal if we had different people doing it, but the question is, what happens if this agreement is rejected? And I have two overriding objectives. One is, I think a nuclear-armed Iran is a threat to this country, a grave threat. And the President, all the administration officials, and the opponents all agree on that fact. And the other objective is to avoid military conflict. And certainly any military conflict that involves our American troops on the ground. I know a lot about the military alternatives. I'm on the Armed Services Committee. I've received a good deal of information, and I can tell you without disclosing anything that's classified, the military options here are complicated and challenging, and potentially very costly. So the question is, sanctions? Increase sanction? Will our partners come back to join sanction? Can we impose unilateral sanction that would bring Iran back to the table and secure a better deal? These are pretty grave uncertainties. There are risks on the other side as well as to what may happen if Iran violates the deal. And how reliable is the process that would detect and prove violations, and then what happens in remedies? Would it be all or nothing? In other words, do all of the sanctions have to be re-engaged? Would that actually happen in case of a violation? These are uncertainties. These uncertainties are troubling as well. So I'm asking questions, and in fact, I have a call tonight with one of the very top administration officials to pursue some of these questions in greater depth. I've been meeting with the Secretary of State, Secretary of Energy, all of the top officials who have knowledge, including a good deal of our military staff. And excuse me for asking, for keeping your hand.
No, I'm just making sure that, excuse me, I live in Connecticut. I appreciate what you're doing with these veterans and PTSD and everything that's going on as far as suicide and going to war. We have a very short time frame. We only have 42 days to really nip this in the bud. Murphy came out and supported the deal. Bernie Sanders just came out. Xi Jinping. Like, oodles and oodles of these Democrats are coming out to support this deal because the alternative is war. And I have friends who are in the military. I have friends whose kids could potentially be in the military. I don't want to see them go to war. So what I'm asking you, I'm proud to live in Connecticut. It's a great state. I have nothing but good things to say about you. I work in politics. What I'm asking you is please really give this some thought before you might possibly oppose this deal, because there is no other alternative on the table. And we're talking lives. We're talking depression. We're talking kids without parents. These are real things that are affecting us. And I get that we don't have an idea of, you know, sanctions that A, B, C, D could go wrong. But what we're looking at right now is this deal that these people came together and said, okay, let's try this, or the alternative, which is war. And I myself never support war. I support the troops, don't support the war. So I'm asking you, as a young person that lives in this state, has children here, please, 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 really think about this. And really,
amen.
Well, I appreciate that point of view. I thank you for expressing it. I too have children in this state. I'm not a young person anymore, but
you have, you understand. Chris
but I understand, in fact, one of my wife and I, four children, is in the military.
Exactly.
So I have one who served in the Marine Corps. We have another who is currently in the military. So this is an issue where I have some skin in the game, and that's not going to affect my judgment, my personal situation. And frankly, the polls are not going to drive me one way or the other. And I'm going to talk to my colleagues, but I'm not marching in lockstep with anyone. I have to decide on an issue of this consequence as a matter of conviction and conscience.
Absolutely. And you have to face your choices. And I'm apologizing for having my hand up, but I am a young female, and I wanted to make sure my voice is heard. So I thank you for that. I thank you for your answer. And I'll be back here next time you come. So we'll stop.
Thank you. I hope you are back the next time.
Oh, I'll be there. Sure.
I hope I'm invited back.
No, in all honesty, thank you for what you're doing for this state. It's a proud place to live. Thanks, Liz.
Thank you. You get to ask a question or make a comment or...
Well, the answer, most of what I had to, was curious about.
Can everybody hear?
Yes.
I can assure you, I've worked on this subject for many years in the International Atomic Energy Agency, where I was one of the authors of the verification system. And I can assure you, it is an extremely effective instrument on which, at least if the government's concerned, support the organization, you can really rely. But I have to say that it is, I have to repeat, my work is to go on supporting the organization, because it's so strange that when things go well, countries have a tendency to say, okay, fine, now we don't have to bother anymore. We've seen that with the extension of the Non-Proliferation Treaty in 1975, when a decision had to be made whether that treaty would remain in force or would lapse. And when it was decided that it would remain in force, all of a sudden there was no further support for the non-governmental organizations that had worked for that things. Totally forgetting that there still are proliferation problems, of which the uranium is an obvious example. So, I must say very strongly, the verification system, if adequately supported, is extremely helpful.
If adequately supported.
If adequately supported.
Well, that, as a matter of fact, is one of the questions I've been asking. And I know about how important support is for enforcement agencies. That has nice work, not just the Department of Justice, but the National Highway Safety Administration, NHTSA. I'm willing to bet that very few people can tell you off the top of your head what this agency does, but it protects us on the roads from defective automobiles. It has been under-resourced. It's been starved of resources. It's an effective agency if it gets the resources it needs. And we need to make sure that it does. I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
No, no, it's me, but I have to say thank you very much.
Thank you, yeah.
Senator, I strongly urge you to support the Iranian agreement. I'm Jewish, I've lived in Israel, and two things. One, I think that the voices in Israel that support the agreement have been drowned out. Number one. Number two, that no one is looking at, and that is if there is no agreement, and Israel then takes military action with, I assume, our cooperation, are the Iranians then just going to sit by? What is going to stop them from sending missiles towards Israel?
May I say one thing? Don't forget that Israel has one.
Right. Yes. And no IAEA.
Yeah. And in a wartime situation, there are unintended consequences. Israel would be threatened, even more so if there is no agreement.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
I have a question regarding the agreement also, but I'm interested in if you're getting any feedback from our coalition partners at the table on where their countries are as far as accepting the agreement and how the impact of our country not accepting the agreement would impact our relationship with the people who are at the table.
That's another good question. In my view, one of the considerations in what we do has to be what will be the impact on the ability of the United States to lead the world. If our president has negotiated an agreement that's then repudiated or rejected by the Senate, what happens to not just his personal credibility, but the credibility of the United States as a negotiating partner? And I've talked to the ambassadors of those countries who are partners in the negotiation. Obviously, they're hopeful that the Senate will not reject the deal, but frankly, they feel a certain ambivalence about it as well, as we all do, because a stronger agreement might have been preferable, but I think on balance, the leaders of those countries are backing the agreement. So I think, just in quick summary, our partners will adhere to the agreement if we accept it as well. And what they do if Congress rejects it is a major unknown. And what Iran does if Congress rejects it is a major unknown and a great uncertainty. Yeah.
I know we're asking a lot of questions about Iran because this is what's on everybody's minds, but what would be the downside of trying this, trying diplomacy first, trying to do this, and then if it didn't work? I think Obama spoke fairly strongly that if it didn't work, if they were breaking anything, we have all these other alternatives. But talking about whether we could have gotten a better agreement, it's the fourth has already left the barn, and somehow I think Kerry probably tried as hard as he possibly could, and people were agreeing with him. So I'm just curious why, given all of this and having no alternative but war, why you wouldn't try this first?
I'm going to answer the question, but on all of these questions, I don't want you to misread what I'm telling you as my endorsing the arguments that I am giving you. You're asking for, in effect, an explanation from the opponents in response to a very good question. And I'll tell you what they would say, what they've said to me. But it goes to the heart, really, of whether to accept the agreement. There is a school of thought that time is not on our side. That the billions of dollars that Iran receives when the sanctions are lifted, it's not just the $50 or $100 billion that they will receive in the first year or the first period of time, but the strengthening in finances and potentially in research that they may do. And they will certainly continue to have strong conventional forces. So the argument is twofold. Number one, they will continue to make mischief with more resources in the area. And number two, they will be in a stronger position to deter as time goes on. So at the end of 5 years, or the end of 10 years, and 10 years, 10 to 15 years is about as long as we get under this agreement, both stronger militarily, and what alternatives do we have if during that time, or at the end of that time, they move from a nuclear threshold state to a nuclear arms race, or they move even to the threshold. And then sanctions and military force. Well, the longer time goes on, so this answer to your question would go, the harder it is to get our allies and partners to join us in sanctions. Why? Well, I mean, all of you have seen the rush to Tehran by the trade ministries and the companies that want to do business there. The more investment there is in Iran, the more we do business with them. It may have the effect of opening Iran. The optimists would say that they will be more friendly to us the more we trade with them. But the other side would say, well, it'll be more difficult to impose sanctions. So the snapback will be more difficult to impose. And I'll just give you a little bit of insight. I was one of the senators who argued successfully for strengthening the sanctions. And I think it helped bring Iran to the table. The administration was pretty doubtful. We had to literally move. A number of my colleagues and I wrote the passed resolution. And I think it had an effect. So they were very difficult to impose. And the administration, to its credit, rallied our partners, including China and Russia, but not without great difficulty. So would that be possible at the end of 5 years, at the end of 10 years? And if not, what are our alternatives then? And the argument that time is not on our side, I think, is the major reason that some folks are against trying it, just kind of trying it. But I think that the point you make is absolutely one of the arguments that the administration makes. It wouldn't make it quite that way. I think it would say that it's realistic to think it will work, that we're not just trying something, that it will work.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, getting away from Iran, since you're on the Commerce Committee, I think this is perfect.
We can come back to Iran.
You're really dying to. I have become a cancer patient. So many people are nowadays. I'm very concerned about the cost of drugs and the fact that the U.S. is not negotiating prices for drugs. And that, I think, could bring us down as far as the ACA, Medicare, Medicaid. An example is my chemo charges. And this also goes to billing. We have got to get rid of the way billing is now. So the provider charge was $40,000 per round of chemo. This is very conventional. It's been around for decades. The allowed charge was $23,000. I was told to look at the allowed, not the provider. And the out-of-pocket charge was about $3,600. An NIH site showed that $3,600 was the actual cost for my chemo that I was taking. So I have a couple of questions. First of all, how long do you think, with these kinds of charges, you know, will our government programs last when we're not negotiating drug prices? Secondly, why are insurance companies allowing charges you know, in this case, $23,000 for a $3,600 treatment. So that's just one question. And I actually think the only thing that makes sense that somebody said to me is that they're taking a loss. Okay, they're not going to get this $40,000 or this $23,000 from Medicare. I don't know how all that works, but anyway, if they don't get it, then they can take a loss, and then they can look like they've lost a lot of money and they're not paying their taxes. So that is one thing that I, you know, some people have presented to me. And then the other thing, okay, and then yes. I have one more that I think is you want the other one?
Well, let me just say about pharmaceutical
okay.
contract.
All right.
I have put hard for, well, when I was Attorney General, as well as now, mm-hmm. for the federal government to be able to negotiate those prices. Mm-hmm. And it's been blocked by the pharmaceutical industry. Mm-hmm. In fact, the VA, as some of you may know, can negotiate. Prices are much lower okay. for the VA healthcare system. It's an anomaly, and it's unacceptable that CMS and the rest of our government healthcare system cannot negotiate to drive down those prices. Mm-hmm. And I'm continuing, as you observe, I'm on the congressman, I'm continuing to work on it. I will tell you that I am in minority mm-hmm. right now because the pharmaceutical industry is very strong. Mm-hmm. And also on the issue of misuse of patents, where very often they can prevent generics from being available. Another area would be the failure of insurance companies. I don't know how many of you follow what I did as Attorney General, what I do now. I've been on the insurance companies to cover drugs that are necessary and for them to help drive down the cost of these drugs. And I've raised questions about some of the consolidation and mergers of those insurance companies. Aetna, Humana, and Anthem, Cigna, because of the potential for lack of competition, which will just enhance the ability of the pharmaceutical companies to have their way. So this is a real continuing problem. I'm glad you raised it. Now, next question.
So now, of course, because I had cancer and I had a very healthy lifestyle, I started looking into the problem of chemicals in our food supply, which also get into our water. So I found out that FIFRA, which is the Federal Insecticide, et cetera, Act, there is something called the conditional registration loophole. I don't know if you're aware of this. And this loophole was passed by Congress in 1972. It was supposed to be to allow a few companies to conditionally register their chemicals while testing was undergoing. But there are now 11,000 chemicals out there that are either untested or under-tested because of this loophole. So I don't know if you're aware of it, I'm making you aware of it. I think that loophole needs to be closed, because it is the industrialized countries that have the highest incidence of cancer.
I am aware of the loophole in the law, mm-hmm. and I've taken a position that we ought to try to improve the law, and particularly when it comes also to GMO labeling. Mm-hmm. I believe that consumers should be informed. They have a right to know what's in their food, what are the ingredients, and what's done in the way of GMO, genetic engineering, whatever you want to call it. So I've been the leader in the Senate in a bill that would require the FDA to provide standards for labeling, much as it does now for other ingredients. The House of Representatives actually passed a bill that would preempt state law and take a step back. It would preempt Connecticut's law, Vermont's law, Maine's law. We have one here that is conditional on other states adopting the same kind of law. So the so-called DART Act that passed the House I see some of you nodding, so you know what I'm talking about, would actually supplant or preempt Connecticut's law. And I've opposed it. I'm in favor of GMO labeling. We've had some great events in Washington to try to generate awareness and support, including one most recently with Gwyneth Paltrow. I get to stand next to the girl. And by the way, her mom, Life Danner, she is really wonderful. But it, very seriously, they are supporting this cause. There are a lot of informed people who want better labeling, not less labeling, of food products, and remedying exactly the kind of loophole that you mentioned. So the people know. Yeah.
I have a more local issue regarding the Tiger Grant, and I'm not going to take up people's time because they have a lot of questions, but if I could just have a few minutes of your time before you leave.
Sure. Tiger grants are for transportation. They have nothing to do with animals. But speaking of that, by the way, for anybody who's interested, I've taken a leading role in trying to stop trophy hunting. And I'm one of the leaders in the Senate on animal cruelty, stopping animal fighting, stopping what's called crushing, which is maiming and hurting animals. Really horrendous kinds of practices which continue to exist in this country, inhumane and heinous practices. But transportation, tiger grants are, as you gathered from what I said,
just a couple of minutes of your time.
A real passion. Yes, sir.
How many more schools and movie theaters are going to get shot up before we take a better look at mental health in this country?
Well, you know, we have fought. Chris Murphy and I have together worked, beginning from Sandy Hook. And I had been a leader on this issue well before Sandy Hook. I defended personally Connecticut's assault weapon ban back when I was Attorney General. I went to court, I tried the case, I argued at the state Supreme Court, we won.
Yeah, but the issue I don't really think is guns. It doesn't seem like we can do anything about guns in this country. It seems like, you know, the issue really has to start with mental health. I don't own guns. I'm not for guns. I really think it's great we did the ban on assault weapons. If we could get that fire started and catching across the country, that would be great. But it just seems like mental health just keeps, like, getting line item out.
Your point is well taken, but let me just finish what I was going to say. We proposed, in the wake of Sandy Hook, and I was there on the day it happened, and I will never forget the faces and grief of those parents, as a parent myself of four, on that day. And we proposed laws that will keep guns out of the hands of dangerous people, criminals. School safety, a ban on illegal trafficking, and a mental health initiative. And it was not passed. Now, it got 54 votes. 54 out of 100 is normally a majority. But in the United States Senate, with the rules that we have, the filibuster takes 60. So I'm still hopeful that mental health, along with those other gun safety initiatives, will be passed. But I think that we need to take initiatives on mental health apart from guns.
I agree.
Exactly.
Not just in reaction to the shootings, and you just in theaters and schools and churches, which ought to be safe places, and in thousands of other places, because let's remember, tens of thousands of people every year are victims of gun violence. And mostly don't read their names because it has become so much a fact of life that mostly it's not reported, which is a tragedy itself. What to do about mental health? I actually included in what's called the Elementary, Secondary, and Education Act reauthorization. Just passed the Senate. A mental health initiative for schools so that counselors would be more available on school grounds. Right now, mental health often requires taking a young person out of school. It's an event, people know about it, kids talk about it. Wouldn't it be easier to have a professional on the campus so they didn't have to leave the school? Someone who was in touch with, who needs someone to talk to, that kind of thing. So making these services more available at an earlier age. Whether that would have prevented Adam Lanza, you know, we'll never know. But maybe we can reach kids before they become dangerous to themselves or others. And at every other level as well. More mental health initiatives. You know, I was talking about the VA. They need mental health professionals to administer to the veterans who have mental health challenges. Now, their challenges often are a result of combat, but a lot of the trauma that goes on in the streets of some of our neighborhoods or in their personal lives may affect young people. And, you know, I think that mental health really should be a major initiative. Now, the Affordable Care Act, the Affordable Care Act provides more health care, mental health care. When I was the Attorney General of the state, I worked with some of the members of our delegation and some of the others on a bill called Mental Health Parity. So that mental health would be regarded on a parity with physical health. And just within, I think, the past year, the regulations have been handed down. So maybe the insurance company will cover mental health care as they should. It's a continuing battle for funds, for awareness, and to remove the stigma so that we provide those services. But thank you for that comment. You're absolutely right. It's not just about them.
No, but we need to do something about guns, yes, too.
And I'm continuing to work on gun violence. I want, no one should think that we're not, both Senator Murphy and I, that we're not going to continue to work.
So what's the strategy, Senator? I mean, if we're 6 votes short, how do we get that? And what kind of legislation will we introduce next to try to address what Chris just talked about? What's the game?
The strategy is to get better makeup in the United States Senate.
Yay!
I don't want to seem too partisan, but we need a Democratic majority, yes, and a Democratic president,
yes,
and we'll get it done. I think that the mood of the country is moving. You know, keep in mind, Ronald Reagan was almost assassinated. You all remember,
yes,
this moment in our history? Ronald Reagan was almost killed, and Jim Reagan was paralyzed. And it still took 10 years to get the Brady Bill. Think of it. Yeah. 10 years. So this is, you know, my original line now is an overused one. It's a marathon, not a sprint. We need to be in there for the long haul. And my hope is that we will get the right makeup of the United States Senate. If we can get it through the Senate, the House will approve it if it's given a vote.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So jumping off of what you're saying about getting the right Senate, I have a grave concern about the gutting of the Voting Rights Act and what it means in various states where they have been very religiously passing all of these ways to keep Democrats from voting. What's the inner Attorney General in you thinking about that, and what actions are being taken by the Senate?
You know, there's another example, and you know, I feel like I should apologize that we don't have a majority, but you know, I didn't do it, and I worked hard for my colleagues. Who unfortunately lost, but the simple answer is shining a light on voter suppression. We need to focus on it, publicize it, fight the efforts to conceal it. And the decision in Texas was a good one. You know, they struck down the voter ID law there, the photographic requirement, but this is going on all over the country. We held a hearing on it and tried to restore the section of the Voting Rights Act that was struck down. Ironically, we're celebrating the 50th anniversary, as you know, of the Voting Rights Act. And voter suppression is ongoing in this country. And so for the immediate term, we should shine a light on any kind of voter suppression laws, try to get them into the courts, try to strike them down. We're not going to pass a new law between now and the election in 2016. But we can fight it in other ways. Voter suppression essentially denies people one of the most fundamental rights of our democracy. The other thing that really troubles me, and we're not going to be able to do much about it from now and the next election, is Citizens United. Or not just the Supreme Court decision of Citizens United, but the flood, the deluge of spending. Unbridled, unreported, undisclosed spending. And it's no secret, I'm running for re-election. I haven't declared it. You know, I'm going to make the announcement at the right time. But I love my job, so of course I'm seriously considering in 2016. And I know there is going to be
you're just
a lot of spending. And that troubles me greatly for what it does potentially to our political system. It is corrupting and corrosive for billionaires, in effect, to be able to spend virtually without limit on their political campaign or other political campaigns. Yes, sir.
You suggested that the country is moving just a minute ago. He said, I wonder what your thoughts are about Connecticut. Now, I remember moving or not. I remember I was not registered. I was a wild card. And then I moved to Connecticut. And you decided to run for senator. And the opponent appeared. I forget her name. The woman looks like a chicken. And she's a wrestling company. I immediately ran as fast as I could to help the Democrats, and I actually helped them in their campaign.
And
so my well, you should, you won. But my question is not really a question. I wonder if you could comment on how you feel Connecticut is moving. In the sense that I was shocked how close that election was. Shocked. Because up here, Connecticut looks differently from, I guess, it does Greenwich and other places. I want just to, might not want to talk about a really dismal and things like elections. But how are you seeing it right now?
Well, what I can tell you, number one, is if I run for re-election, I will work as I have in all six elections that I've won statewide. I run like I'm an underdog. And I take nothing for granted. And the reason is that we're a very independent state. We are a state of independent thinkers. And a lot of folks tell me, and they have from the days when I was in the state legislature, you know, we don't vote for the party. We vote for the person. When I was Attorney General, I served for 20 years in that position. I know that's a little frightening, but I love the job, and I'm a Democrat, proud to be a Democrat. And I agree mostly with the President, who's a Democrat, and with my colleagues who are Democrats, but I try to make up my own mind on things, particularly talking about the running. And I serve under three governors, none of them was a Democrat. So Connecticut can elect Republican, and it elects, Lowell Weicker called himself an independent, Connecticut moving. I don't know what the party registration shows, but I do think on the issue of guns, Connecticut strongly supports common sense measures to stop gun violence. And I think Connecticut strongly supports environmental preservation and open space measures and clean air and clean water. As Attorney General, I fought for them, and I do now. I think Connecticut believes that our present course of action is potentially destroying our planet, that we need to stop carbon emissions better than we have before. And I've worked on that for a lot of years as well. So I think Connecticut on issues is moving in a direction that I think is very good. We need to do more to create jobs and drive our economy forward. I haven't talked much about it, but one of the reasons why I favor investing in our roads and bridges and rail is it is a job creator. And one of the reasons why I favor a better education system is because there are job openings right now, a couple of hundred at White Oak, for example. But manufacturers can't find people with the right skills, or employers generally. So we need to match the skills with the jobs. And that's where Connecticut, I think, also can play a leading role. So I'm very proud to represent Connecticut. I regard what I do in getting around the state as very important. Listening is one of the most important things I do. There's an old saying that God gave us two ears and one mouth. A little more listening and talking. I don't know that my four children were to do it, but. And the other thing is, you know, being here in Cornwall just a couple weeks ago, being here tonight, I love getting around the state. There's a saying, a few of you may have heard it, that if there's a garage door opening, Blumenthal will be there. And I think people want to make fun of me when I say it, but I actually kind of, I'm proud of the fact that I do get around and I listen to people.
Senator, one thing I haven't heard anything about tonight is women's reproductive rights. Can you speak to that?
Yes, very definitely. Today I visited Planned Parenthood in New Haven, really just to tell the remarkable professionals there that I'm going to continue to stand with them and fight for them against efforts to defund Planned Parenthood. For me, one of the core reasons in public life. I was a law clerk to Justice Harry Blackmun on the United States Supreme Court in 1974-75. I know that's frightening for some of you, but that was the year after Roe v. Wade was decided, and he wrote it. And I have been involved as the U.S. Attorney in Connecticut, the Chief Federal Prosecutor, as a member of the state legislature, where I led the effort to codify Roe v. Wade, so it wouldn't be at the mercy of the Supreme Court, as Attorney General, where I fought for clinic access against the efforts to intimidate or block women from going to our clinics, and now in the United States Senate, where I have led the fight against efforts to defund Planned Parenthood. I closed the debate this past week. Last week, just before the Senate voted. And fortunately, we blocked that effort to defund Planned Parenthood. We prevailed 8 times. Believe it or not, there have been 8 attempts to defund Planned Parenthood, which is part of a broader war on women's health care and reproductive rights. And so to answer your question very directly, I'm going to continue to fight this battle. I think we'll continue to win it, in part because of that detestable filibuster rule that I mentioned earlier, because we can muster the 40 votes we need to continue to lead the effort. Remember that women go to Planned Parenthood for basic health care. Cervical and breast cancer screening, testing for STD, prenatal care, so they have healthy babies, all kinds of health care services that have nothing to do with abortion. As a matter of fact, they help prevent unwanted and unintended pregnancies, which then can lead to abortion. So reproductive rights are one of the reasons I'm in the U.S. Senate, and if I didn't feel that way, I can tell you, my wife, Cynthia, feels as strong as I do, and whether it's Planned Parenthood, or the Center for Reproductive Rights, or a number of these organizations, Planned Parenthood is the only one. And I'll just leave you on that topic with this thought. The great threat now is not so much at the federal level. It's at the state level. Not here in Connecticut, fortunately. I'm very proud that Connecticut actually has led the way on this, going back to Griswold. But in Oklahoma and Kansas and Texas, there are state laws that restrict clinic operation because they don't have the right hallway width, or their doctors don't have admitting privileges in hospitals, which are a ruse. You know, they say they're protecting women, but they're just designed to shut down clinics. And so I offered a measure called the Women's Health Protection Act, which would stop these restrictive state laws. We have more than 30 members of the Senate who have supported it. And I'm going to continue working, not just at the federal level, but also to protect against the restrictive state laws that are equally a threat. And I think this is one of those issues where we will be measured and tested as a society.
Senator, can I just raise perhaps a rather dry topic? I know that there are new proposed regulations by the Department of Labor with regard to increased fiduciary responsibilities for those in the financial industry and their clients. I would ask you to take a second look, because I received a letter from your office saying you do support it, but I am asking you if you would be kind enough to relook at it. I'd like to pass up to you comments by the chief CEO of FINRA, the Financial Industry Regulatory Agency.
Right.
And the SEC, both of whom feel that those proposed regulations may have unintended consequences. So
I'd be glad to have another look at it. As you know, there is a history here. It's at least a four-year history. I asked the Department of Labor to have a second look at the regulations that they initially issued.
Yeah, I mean, I agree that we need bad apples out of the industry. I don't be the first to support it. But I think the unintended consequences of what has been proposed. Also, it was interesting because Dodd-Frank, apparently, they tasked the SEC with doing that, and it appears that the Department of Labor is also now involved. I have also included in that booklet that I'm giving you not only the comments by FINRA, but also all of some of the things that I need to submit when I have a client with regard to disclosures, and what I have to submit to compliance, and to the state, and to FINRA, and to the SEC. So that I want you to appreciate the transparency that we do have in the industry as well. So, if you would be so kind, that's all I wanted to say. And thank you so much.
Sure. Other question? Yes, sir.
I'm actually a member of UConn, Craig, and I'd like to thank you for all the positive work that you've done for us, helping with consumer action and college affordability. I'm actually running a campaign with UConn Purdue on transit safety, and I was wondering if I could have some time with you after this is all said and done, so we can coordinate our efforts.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I have a call that I have to take, and I'm going to have to leave. And I really want to thank you again for these very, very pertinent and important questions and comments. I've learned something, believe it or not. I hope, I won't be so presumptuous to suggest you have, but on all these issues and a lot of others, I'm going to keep working, and I'll just leave you one last thought. I'm sometimes asked, what's the biggest case you had as Attorney General? What's the most important case, the most important law that you've done in U.S. Senate? And I think people expect me to say, well, it's fighting the tobacco companies or, you know, one of the big antitrust cases that we've done. And in fact, it is literally the thousands of cases where we have fought for consumer, where we have worked on insurance companies, on healthcare, to get them to cover pharmaceutical drugs that people needed, or surgery, when the insurance companies said no, you went to bat for people. If you have a way, if you think of a way I can be helpful to you, people come up to me now and then and they say, you really helped me the other day. And I'll say, how did that happen? Because I don't know you. And I'll say, I called the car dealership or the appliance salesman. And I said, if you don't help me, I'm going to call Blumenthal. Now, you know, I'm always thankful to help people, even indirectly. But I'm also very focused on economic growth and job opportunities. I want to help small businesses. Small businesses are the major job creators in our society. And so when I work on defense issues, when I work on education, and college affordability is a great example, I really have in mind creating jobs, moving the economy forward. So all of it, this is to say, if I can help you, please don't hesitate. Call. Thank you for having me.